Hello, everyone. We're just going to give it a few seconds as people start to trickle in here. Okay, so it seems like most of our participants have logged in, so I'm gonna start the webinar. So hello and welcome. I'm Cole Howie, a current MBA student at Carnegie Mellon University's Tepper School of Business. It is a pleasure to be with you here today for our WL Mellon Speaker Series address. This series, which debuted in 2006, was designed to give students the opportunity to interact with global leaders, CEOs, and management experts. We are pleased to open it to alumni as well in this virtual format. Now, it is with great pleasure that I get to introduce Revathi Advaithi, the Chief Executive Officer of Flex. Flex is a $24 billion manufacturing company with a workforce of 160,000 spanning over 30 countries. Revathi joined Flex as CEO in 2019 and previously held executive level positions at Eaton and Honeywell. She currently serves on the board of directors for Uber and Catalyst.org. Revathi was recognized as one of Fortune's most powerful women for the last three consecutive years and is the co-chair of the World Economic Forum Advanced Manufacturing CEO Community. Revathi has a bachelor's degree in mechanical engineering from the Birla Institute of Technology and Science in Pulani, India, and holds an MBA from the Thunderbird School of Management. She is a passionate advocate for diversity and inclusion in the workforce, as well as STEM education for girls. Revathi, welcome and thank you for being here today. It is an honor for us to host you. Today's event was shaped by our club co-sponsors, the Operations and General Management Club, the South Asian Business Association, the Business and Technology Club, and Tepper Women in Business. They have prepared a variety of questions for you to discuss, and I'm looking forward to listening to your remarks. Participants, you can submit live questions using the Q&A function during the talk, and I will return later in the event to incorporate as many as possible with today's discussion. I will now turn it over to my fellow MBA classmate, Meghna Sharma, Professional Development Officer of the Graduate Business Association, to begin the moderated conversation. Meghna?
Thanks, Cole. And thank you, Revathi, again, for being here and taking time out of what I can only imagine is an extremely hectic schedule. I've been looking forward to this chat for a while now, and I know that our attendees are also super keen to hear from you. So just going to outline the theme of our conversation. We'll talk a little bit about leadership and in particular, your professional journey, Flex's transformation over time, specifically through COVID, no surprise there. And we'll wrap up with some career advice from you.
Great. Thank you, Meghna. Look forward to the conversation.
Awesome. So I'm just going to jump right in and not waste any time. Start with your leadership journey. What motivated you to choose the career that you currently have today?
Yeah, Meghna, now this is like you have to go back in history because I was making my decision for undergrad school in 1986. And, you know, growing up in India, you had to make sure you didn't have all the options of, you know, what you could choose because you couldn't change your mind once you went in. I chose mechanical engineering because I always thought that I was very hands-on and I liked things that I could physically work with. And I really didn't know what it meant. I didn't have a lot of kind of mentorship and things like that in terms of figuring out which engineering discipline I wanted. I knew that those days, you know, electrical, electronics, computer science was hot, but I felt like mechanical was more me. And so I chose it, I ended up getting it until I landed in college and I realized, oh, women don't take mechanical engineering. And I was the only woman in the class. And I think the only woman in the entire program for a while. So it, you know, it was just because I thought I was passionate about something and I ended up going there and then realized like it was just something that wasn't very specific to my gender, but loved it, really loved the hands-on nature of it. And even as the world migrated, you know, from mechanical engineer to IT and computer science, you know, I kind of stuck with the manufacturing field, you know, just because I like to see how things are made and I just enjoy that aspect of it. So the more tangible aspect of engineering, and that's kind of how I ended up with an engineering degree and then eventually got an MBA.
Awesome. Thank you for that. It's Yeah, I remember being the only girl in a few of my classes as well, and it's an interesting journey. So it's,
I know it becomes a theme, you know, you don't think much about it when it starts, and then as you kind of start progressing through your work life and things like that, then you understand that becomes a theme that you start to see, and the lessons you learn early on, you know, become really valuable in terms of how you navigate things, particularly if you don't have many women around you.
Yeah. And I think that leads us into a good second question with that theme. What actually motivated you to step up and become a leader in the organization?
Yeah, so I think my journey almost happened by chance. So I finished my engineering in India. I was working there for a couple of years. And then decided, like most immigrants, to come to the United States in the early 90s to do my master's. And when I was doing my master's in University of Oklahoma in industrial engineering, and realized I really wanted to do an MBA but couldn't afford it, so started looking for campus jobs and landed up with this company called Eaton Corporation, which is it's a power management company. Focuses really on manufacturing. And they had a site in Shawnee, Oklahoma. And so I ended up getting a job. I was super excited because I desperately needed a job and I needed the money. And, the one of my first roles there was a shop floor supervisor. So I got to supervise, around 50 kind of mainly men who were shop floor operators and running machines and equipment. And that was kind of my first leadership role. And I didn't know what it meant. And this was kind of, mid 90s, didn't have, all the internet tools and everything that we have today, but I was just kind of thrown into it. But I enjoyed the people aspect of it a lot. So for me, it was all about getting to know the people I was working with. And I was a, Indian woman who had come to Shawnee, Oklahoma. I didn't know much about the culture. So for me, leadership ended up becoming understanding who I was working with, what was the passion for them, what drove them. So it became almost a psychology lesson of kind of hanging out with people and understanding what motivates them. And that's how my leadership journey started, I would say. And I didn't even think about it as leadership. It became more about like what motivates somebody to do something. Like how can you convince someone to do something that they may not be motivated by, but I think is important. So it became all about understanding kind of the human psychology and what it takes to motivate and inspire people. And that's kind of how my leadership journey started. And I just enjoyed that aspect of it. And, and then really leading a group of kind of shop floor employees is a whole different experience altogether, because a passion and motivation for them is very different than a group of engineers or a group of MBA students. And it teaches you a lot, I think, when that's kind of where your leadership journey starts. And then it continued to kind of build from there. But that was kind of my first role, managing people. And it was quite an impactful role for me.
That's beautiful. And you've obviously, starting from a role like that and with your background, it takes a lot of confidence and resilience to sort of fall into those positions and step up and lead, and even understanding different people. So how have you built your confidence and resilience over the course of your career?
Meena, I think that's, such an important question, because I think what happens, I view my career journey as a sequence of unplanned steps, that somehow added up to something and here I am, right? So, but I think you have to look at each of those pieces of those journey and understand how you made your decisions and, what brought that resiliency in your career. And I would say each one had a different flavor to it as I kind of grew in my career. So as I kind of am wrapping up Shawnee, Oklahoma, and was going to another, kind of middle of nowhere place, Hutchinson, Kansas, and I was doing a product line management role. So it was my first foray into a non-technical role where I had to figure out how to run a P&L. I think my learnings from that was I jumped into something I absolutely didn't know. You know, I didn't know what a P&L meant. I didn't know what a balance sheet meant, right? And then I had to figure that out. It was literally picking up a finance book from the local bookstore and reading it to know what it meant. And it had no relevance to what you did every day. But, you know, so you just have to have the confidence that you can figure it out. And not just that, you know, my role, my next role had a lot of customer interactions. And so you had to do things like hunting and fishing. And, you know, I had like no capability in hunting and fishing, but like I had to kind of step in and learn that because I was part of, you know, my customer facing role, right? And that required its own resiliency. So each part of the journey had something about making decisions that I wasn't comfortable with, that I either chose to do or somebody told me, you know, hey, it's okay to do that. And you know, you should figure it out. You know, years later, I ended up getting married, I had two kids. And actually, when I was pregnant with my first child, I was offered a job to move to England and do a turnaround job for Eaton. And I was like 3 months pregnant, you know, and it was my first child. So it was kind of interesting to kind of say, you know, is this something we should do? And, you know, we decided to do it, my husband and I, because we thought, why not? Like, you know, and so each time we made a decision, now you look back, you think, oh my, why did you make that decision? That looks crazy. But it was all about step out of your comfort zone, think you can do it even if you can't, and just jump in and build some character as you do it. And you know, there were many missteps along the way as you did that. It's not as though everything was a good decision, but even those missteps were learning points in terms of what added up to kind of, I would say, my eventual journey to where I am. So a whole series of, you know, points in my career where I made decisions I wasn't comfortable with, jumped in and took risks, learned from those either positives or not so positive experiences. And that eventually kind of, you know, built up a career to where things are today.
Amazing. Yes, that sounds like the embodiment of be comfortable with being uncomfortable.
Yes.
Oh, that's amazing. And in terms of being uncomfortable, this is something I worry about as a young professional woman. How do you balance your career, personal life, and passions? And is there such a thing as balance?
You know, I don't know what balance means, because if in the context of work-life balance as a word, you know, it bothers me because I feel like my life and my work are one big thing. You know, my work is my life in many ways, right? And I don't like to separate the ideas because I have as much passion about my work as I have for hiking, as an example, right? I love both. And so for me, when I think about balance, I always think about in the journey of life, you know, am I happy? Am I satisfied? Am I enjoying my life? Am I giving time to all the things I want to give time to? And I don't think about it as a day or a week. I think about kind of in the journey of life, do I feel like, you know, this is a fulfilling journey? And sometimes that is hard. It sounds very philosophical today, but, you know, there has been many moments where that is not easy or that's not, you know, that's not a straightforward decision. And like when you are a younger parent and you have two young children, right? You aren't thinking about, hey, am I having a fulfilling journey? You're just trying to put one foot in front of the other and get through the day and get to the office and pick up that suitcase and travel and still make it to all your kids' events. And those times it is very, very difficult. And you have to build up a support system you're comfortable with. And you have to build up a relationship, right, with your family and your support system that you're comfortable with. But I look back at all those events and I look back at, you know, where things are today. And I always say, as you're progressing through those decision points and that journey of life, do you feel like it's a fulfilling journey? Are you happy with it? Are you able to step back and kind of say, hey, this is fun, right? It's difficult, but it's fun. And that's kind of how I think about, you know, work-life balance or balance in general. And when I'm like super overwhelmed with something, or I'm just, you know, I'm having a difficult week or a month, I do a crazy thing. Like I'll pick up like a most useless, like a mystery book, and then I'll just like sink my teeth into it for 24 hours straight till I come out of it. And I kind of feel good, you know, oh, that felt nice, right? And so I think you just have to find your ways of creating balance and creating an atmosphere you're comfortable with. And I'll tell you, as a woman, it is in our genetics, it is in our biology that we just feel guilty about everything, right? Doesn't matter what it is, we're built that way. We feel guilty we're not calling our mom. We feel guilty we're not being an amazing wife. We feel guilty we're not being the perfect boss. And you just have to figure out that in your journey of life, how you deal with those emotions. So there's lots of things that happen when you think about balance. And you have to find a support system that gets you through all those events in life. But you have to step back and say, am I happy? Am I satisfied? If I'm not, let me go do something else. So I always look at all the women who are my friends, my colleagues, my support system, and our conversations are always about, is it a satisfying time? Are we having fun doing what we're doing? And if you're doing that, it's all good. If it's not, just go do something else. And so I would say balance is a tough thing to achieve. It's all in your context of what you want to do.
That's beautiful. Thank you. I actually really value that. Because being happy and being fulfilled is something that I've always sort of taken as my North Star. So it's good to hear that
you're starting young, Meghna. That's even better, right? So that's inspirational to hear young people like you who are already thinking about that, right? And I would say, you know, we've come such a long way. My generation was a little different. And for us, it was all about just figure out how to get through the next day. But, you know, if you're already there and thinking about it, I think that's a huge step in the right direction.
Thank you. Amazing. I'm just going to now pivot more towards questions that are focused on flex a little bit more. Mm-hmm. No surprise here. How has COVID changed Flex's approach to support some of the largest companies in the world?
Yeah, you know, let me tell you just a little bit about Flex so it puts you in context in the pandemic. So Flex is around a $24, $25 billion company. And we have a large employee base because we make things. We're a contract manufacturing company. We have 160,000 plus employees distributed across the world. And we make everything from automotive products to health products to vacuum cleaners to hair straighteners. Like you think of something, we make it. So our factories, we make critical data center infrastructure products. So our factories are really important to be running, to kind of run the world. And we're in the top three manufacturing companies in the world. And between the three of us, you know, we're a huge amount of what gets made around the world. And so when COVID happened and the world went into shutdown and everybody went home, including myself, the first thing that comes to mind is, well, that's very nice, you know, work from home. But we can't, because one is we need healthcare products. Two is everybody needs to work from home. So data centers around the world need to run, and everybody wants their networking gear, their security gear, their switching routers, everything. You need more laptops. And suddenly here we are in this situation where we don't know what the pandemic is. We don't know what COVID means, but 160,000 employees have to show up to work. So we didn't have the luxury that everybody else has, which is let me go home and work from home. And that was the basis of how the pandemic looked for us. So we have customers who say they want their product, and we have us making decisions that I was very clear. The most important thing to me was the health of my colleagues around the world. And all the decisions was going to be based around our value of what is the right thing to do. And the right thing to do is always put your colleagues first. And so we had that balance of trying to figure out till we know how this works and how this pandemic is going to evolve, we have to figure out how to support our customers. So that was like the biggest thing that we went through in the early stages of the pandemic. And then as we got all that correct, social distancing, masking, all that stuff, and got all that right, then it became all about, here you have six different end markets you support. Each of them are moving in many different directions, right? So automotive shutdowns and shutdowns because nobody's buying cars and there's all kinds of automotive shutdowns. Consumer products going through the roof because everybody's sitting at home and ordering all this stuff for their house. Data centers going on, you know, a lot of, you know, deliveries happening. In healthcare, you know, we didn't make ventilators and suddenly every customer wants us to make ventilators. We had to go from zero to like thousands of ventilators in 2 months. So we really had to learn so many different things in a short period of time. And it just all became about really being focused on how do you solve the here and now as you keep what is important in front of you. And so that's kind of how the pandemic has evolved for us, you know, through the last couple of years. And even now, you know, a lot of us think that pandemic is over and, you know, things are getting better, but Shanghai is in a shutdown, right? There are employees in Shanghai who can't get fruits and vegetables and food in their house. And we're trying to figure out how to deliver food to our employees' houses. So we're doing this every single day and through the last couple of years. And we have learned a lot from this exercise. But our North Star has been do what's right for your colleagues, right? And if you keep that in front of you and you make sure that's the most important thing, your customers will be happy and they will support you because you're doing the right thing. So that's kind of how the pandemic has, hopefully that story kind of paints a picture for all of you that, you know, while it's super cool to think that you're the CEO of a large company, when you're making decision that affects the lives of 160,000 employees, that's the most important thing you can do. It's just, are you doing the right thing for them?
Thank you for that. That's very inspiring. And seeing as you sort of hold values as your North Star, I guess, with that in mind, how do you see your company's growth going forward from here?
Yeah, you know, first I'll tell you is that, you know, we have seen amazing growth this year, even with the pandemic and the supply chain crisis, right, which has been significant. And I always say that nobody knew what supply chain was, so they came into this year. And then every two-year-old kid is talking about supply chain, right? So even with that, we'll be delivering north of 7% growth, you know, as we think about this year. And so for us, you know, as I look forward, first is kind of almost every business segment is growing. But let me talk about the macro themes of what's driving growth. One of the most important things that is happening in this world is this thing called regionalization or reshoring. And so driven by the trade issues that started, followed by the pandemic, and then followed by kind of the supply chain crisis, the question of resiliency in your supply chain and making sure that you're making products closer to the end consumption is becoming very important to customers. So the idea of, as the world went through globalization over the last few decades, and, you know, Friedman wrote, you know, the world is flat and all of that, I'm sure there will be a sequel coming out to that in the next decade. What is happening is now all these complex supply chains are breaking up and everybody's trying to figure out how to make things closer to the consumption point. So reshoring and regionalization is a huge macro theme that is really gonna drive growth. And we see that in every business. Every customer is looking for optionality and how to build resiliency. I would say the second big theme is, of course, the idea of digitization or digitalization that is happening everywhere, right? So, which means data center growth is explosive, right? There's going to be more cloud providers than we can think of. Now you're thinking about the meta, and so the metaverse is going to drive growth. So everything around that is a huge theme for us because we are a very significant provider into the cloud space. And so that is going to be a huge part of the macro theme that drives growth. So just between those two itself, that you know, has several different verticals that drives growth for us. And then the third big theme is everything around electrification, sustainable energy, So we have a big automotive business and the focus around electric vehicle, autonomous vehicle, chargers at home, inverters, solar presence, all of that is kind of the third big theme. So these three macros is what is driving growth for Flex. And those are the ones that we have picked to really double down on. And as we think about growth moving forward, all our investments, our focus, our technology, our resources are all based around taking full advantage of these three macros that is driving growth for us.
Well, thank you so much for that. That was themed up very nicely. And that's a really good segue into the next question. So what is one piece of advice that you would give to a student looking to build a career in supply chain and operations or technology or a technical career of that sort?
First of all, I'll say that I'd be super excited if people think about manufacturing, supply chain, industrial companies, all of that for a career. Carnegie Mellon has a great program, right, around robotics and around manufacturing. That is a fantastic program. And I'd say first is it's an exciting place to be because there's so much that is changing, right? Whether it is in the areas that I talked about, which is, you know, macros that are driving growth, that drive technology, or where you think about if you're really interested in how things are made and the idea of kind of robots and cobots and the future of manufacturing, there is a lot happening around that, right? And people, you know, I love to give this example that kind of before 2 years ago, we weren't running our programs on simulations and digital twin, right? Today, you can kind of do all of that in this virtual world and deploy it in 2 minutes that wasn't the same as going into the shop floor and trying to, you know, build a new program out. So things are changing in a very, very rapid way. So my advice for anybody who wants to, you know, be in this space is first is don't be afraid to kind of jump in, you know, and I think if you have a passion in this space, there is a lot of good industries that are looking to hire kind of smart MBA students and engineers to really drive, you know, their performance. But in any career, I'd say, Meghna, my advice is, you know, pick what you're passionate about, right? Pick what you really enjoy doing and then find a way to jump into that. I think that is more important than what's cool, what's the next thing to do, or, you know, where do I make the biggest salary? Though that is important, was important to me in 1995 when I had no money, but I'd say just pick something you're passionate about and find a way to jump into that. And that's the best way to start your career in any place. And so I'd say that's the most important advice I'd have.
Thank you. That is extremely valuable. And I might cheat and make this question two part, but it will be the last one. You've been a big advocate for women in STEM in general. And is there sort of any advice that you would give for how women can support other women better in their organizations? And what advice in general would you give to someone who is going into a leadership position for the first time?
First, I'd say, you know, just not women in STEM, but women in all positions, you know, and leadership position is something I feel passionately about. I always say that I make no apologies for it. And the day the world has 50% women in leadership positions, just as it's meant to be, because that's how the population of the world exists, I will be happy and stop talking about this. And, you know, it's a tough fight and it's a big, it's not easy. So I wish I would sit here and tell all the women who are listening to this that, you know, it is, you know, we've solved this problem and it's easier than you think. Well, it has gotten better, right? Over the years, over the decades, even through my 30 years, it's gotten better. But we're still sitting, you know, Flex is a Fortune Global 500 company. We have 5% women CEOs, right? In the Global Fortune 500 list. And it shouldn't be that way. So, you know, I'd say it's really important as women to understand what is it that you want to do. I will say that I have looked at this and have studied this for years. And it is not because women are not capable of doing something. It is not because they're not ready. It's not because they're not risk takers. I feel passionately that women need more sponsors, whether it is men or whether it is women, any success story you look at for women, there is a story of a sponsor involved with it. And typically it is super important to think about who your sponsor network will be. And I talk to young women about this all the time. They'll say, I'm doing such a fantastic job, I'm not getting promoted. Well, if you're just doing a fantastic job sitting behind your desk and it's not getting noticed, then you have to find a way to make sure that your story is followed. You have to make sure that when that decision is getting made about that promotion or that leadership role, who is speaking up for you? Because doesn't matter how the world has progressed, when that decision is made, there are more men sitting and making that decision than women making that decision. So you need sponsors. And that, I feel, is the most important thing that you can do as women, is be clear on who your sponsor network is. And that doesn't mean that you don't have mentors. Mentors are important because you can learn from them. They can be your coaches. And I've had many amazing mentors. But we do tend to get over-mentored at some point in time, right? Even now I have people telling me, I want to be your mentor. I'm like, okay, fine. I would love for you to be my mentor. But frankly, what we need is sponsors. We really need people, decision points, people speaking up for you. So my most important advice to women will be, whether it's men or women, make sure you have the right sponsors. And that is particularly important if you want to go into leadership roles. And that is particularly important, as you think about starting things as a family and you're going to say, hey, I need time off to go have my children and come back. Well, you need your sponsors to be around for you. So they're watching out for you and they know at the point you're ready for that decision point, they're speaking up for you. And I can't underestimate the magnitude of how important this is. And Meghna, I've run study after study in all the companies I've been in. I've talked to my HR teams and my leadership teams, and it'll always come down to, when decisions are made, we always want to promote somebody who looks like us, talks like us, walks like us. And that kind of bias is hard to break. And it's taken years to try to start breaking that bias. And companies have built a lot of good data and intelligence on how to break that bias. So we have a lot of tailwind in our favor to help this. But if we want to take ownership of it, it always has to be build a support system, build a network, build a sponsorship base. And it doesn't come naturally to a lot of women because we are too busy doing our job. We want to do a fantastic job. I want to make my results speak for itself. And I'm the first person who says this, but take the time to make a few phone calls, take the time to build relationships, take the time to have those dinners, and build a support network that'll speak for you. And I'll say that's the most important thing all of you can do.
Thank you for that. That was actually extremely valuable to hear about, like, sponsorship versus mentorship in such a practical sense. And with that, I will wrap up this section of our coffee chat and hand it back over to Cole. And he's going to do a Q&A session.
Hello, Revathi. Thank you for an engaging conversation. I'll just start off here with a question from Camden. He asked, you talked about having the confidence to figure things out and learn things on the job. How do you convince employers that what you lack in previous experience, you'll be able to make up with and learn quickly on the job?
Yeah, that's a great question. I would say, why it's relevant, because I did say jump in and learn, but you have to convince people that they're willing to give you the chance to jump in and learn. I'll first start by saying that it's important to have a broad base of knowledge in something you want to do, right? So for example, if I want to be a business leader, it's important to have some level of understanding and knowledge about how a business would run, how a P&L looks like. I gave the example, I didn't know, what a P&L meant and what it looked like and how to run a P&L. But I could have a basic conversation about it with somebody and they were convinced that, she knew enough that she could figure her way through. So I always say is, make sure in the spaces you're interested in, whether you have work experience or not, build a broad knowledge base, which means that read a lot, right? Read a lot about people who are working in that field or companies who are doing work in that field. And when when you get your few minutes to do your elevator speech, when somebody meets you, they should be able to see, oh, I see that person in the role. They may not have all that experience, but I see that person in the role. So I think convincing requires you to have some level of capability, you know, to talk about that topic in a basic level of intelligence that will convince somebody to say, you know what, I think they can figure this out. So I'd say that's one way to do it. And then the second way to do it is, you know, find one or two people who can educate you on things, right? So when I went into the electrical business, I knew nothing about a circuit breaker. And at some point I was running a $10 billion electrical business. And so I had to spend the time with professors and teachers and learn, but somebody was convinced that she had basic capability to figure this out. So I'd say that would be my best answer is, you know, make sure you have a broad enough knowledge, but it may not be deep and that's okay.
Thank you so much for your answer. We don't have any more questions in the Q&A chat, so I'll take advantage of this time. Something that I had thought about during your discussion with Meghna was you had mentioned how Flex is in multiple different sectors and makes a myriad of different products and product lines. Is there anything as CEO or maybe even, you know, prior to becoming CEO that you found particularly challenging or rewarding about working in, for a company that makes so many different products as compared to maybe a company that would make just one product or be in one specific sector?
Yeah, I would say, you know, most of the roles I was in had very specific sector focus, right? Eaton's electrical business that I led for many years had a wide set of products. You know, we made everything from circuit breakers that sat in your house to giant transformers that sat in a utility station. But it didn't have what Flex has, which is diverse end markets, you know, diverse manufacturing capability. And so that complexity could be overwhelming if you can't think your way through it. So I was excited about that complexity because, you know, I love to see technology and how things are made. But the magnitude of it, I didn't understand till I came into Flex and I got my job, right? So till it's only then when you walk into a factory that in one place is making like hair straighteners and you turn around and another place is making these very complex autonomous car driving systems, do you realize the magnitude of one so regulatory and safety based and one is all about high volume and scale and, you know, so it requires a different level of finesse to be able to run that level of complexity and scale in such a different set of end products. And then, of course, the most important thing is, you know, I don't know half the products we make, right? So I can't go to a health customer. And this happened during the pandemic when suddenly, you know, our customers were telling us, hey, can you make ventilators, right? And everyone says, well, FDA takes 2 years to qualify anybody. It's not going to be easy. And I was just sitting in these meetings and asking like, why? Okay, why would it take that long? And we eventually ended up making our ventilators in 2 months versus 2 years, right? But I knew nothing about it. And that in some ways was a good thing because I will get to ask all the dumb questions, but it was also overwhelming to figure out why does this industry work this way? So there is complexity to this. I was attracted to it, but I was surprised at how complex it was and have been learning on my feet, I'd say the last 3 years on how to, you know, be better at this.
Thank you again for that answer. Yeah, it seems, you know, kind of relevant to the being uncomfortable situation that you talked about earlier. We've had some more questions flood in, and I think this one is particularly relevant to the discussion. So Pragya would like to know, she would appreciate your advice on how to start building a network of sponsors, especially when a day-to-day leadership role and a young family takes all the time for a woman.
I know it's not easy, right? And I wish I could tell you that there was, you know, one easy way to do it, but Pragya, I would say the most important thing is you have to find that small pockets of time. And, you know, I've been having this conversation with, you know, the young women in my family and my friends' families and my colleagues here And I'd say that I can find those 100 moments when you could have, you know, you could pick up the phone and say, hey, listen, I just want to chat with you. And you don't have to do a coffee. You don't have to do a dinner. And at the most, what is that person going to say? No, you know, and I'll tell you, most people don't say no, right? Most people will be excited if somebody says, hey, can I talk to you for 5 minutes just to, you know, get your time? And so I think it's important to try to fit it in bite-sized pieces. Don't try to, you know, you're not trying to solve world hunger here. But Pragya, I'd say, you know, when you want a break from your husband and your kids and your, you know, everything you're doing, and, you know, say 5 minutes, drop somebody an email or a message and say, hey, can you take time to talk to me for 5 minutes? I just want to brainstorm something. And you have to find those bite-sized chunks. And otherwise, it's hard to do. And I will tell you that I didn't do a good job of it. When I think about it, you know, when I had my two kids in 2004, 2005, I was overwhelmed by the magnitude of this. But I do remember, because I enjoyed people and I enjoyed the psychology of people, I would call people all the time and say, hey, do you have a few minutes to chat with me? I'd have no reason to talk to them, but I just ask. And so many people said yes. And that's how I built my network of people who supported me through my life. So no easy answer, Pragya, but do it in bite-sized chunks if you can find the time.
Thank you again. So, and we've had more questions flood in. So next, Laura asks, being CEO is often an aspirational goal for many leaders. What have you learned about being at the top that others may not know?
Yes, one is, I'll tell you that many people said that it is a lonely job. When I talked to CEOs before I came into this role, I didn't understand what that meant. I said, how can any job be lonely? There are so many people around you that you can talk to. But, you know, particularly I think CEO of a public company, you know, when you have investors and quarterly results and, you know, you're always kind of watched in terms of how you're delivering and the balance of the short term and the long term. You know, I've definitely learned that there's nobody else who owns it versus you, right? And so that can end up being a lonely thing sometimes. So one of my amazing friends who's a CEO of another company, this lady, you know, when I became CEO, she called me and she said, the first thing she told me is, Revathi, she said, don't underestimate the magnitude of having a sounding board on the other side so you can keep your sanity as a public company CEO. And I think that's the one thing I've learned, that is very true. I just was, you know, I was very cool about, oh yeah, this will be great. And, you know, I'll figure it out kind of thing. But it is, and particularly what I have gone through in 3 years with, you know, trade and pandemic and now a supply chain crisis, it's good to have kind of people you can, you know, talk to and have a sounding board, because otherwise it can be a lonely job.
Again, thank you for your answer. And we'll move on to the next question here. So this question is from Duncan. He would like to know he'd like to ask what you look for in a sponsor and how you approach building that relationship. I think you touched on the building that relationship portion earlier, but if you could let us know what you look for in a sponsor.
Yeah, I think each one looks for something different, Duncan. Mine was strange in some ways. Like one of the people I absolutely admired in my time growing up at Eaton was the then CEO of Eaton. And I love to tell this story because it means so much to me that when I first joined Eaton, like 1995, and I was this young operations, you know, intern. And I had a lunch with the CEO at that point because I was in some leadership program. And the first thing I learned about Sandy Cutler was his empathy. He was just such a inspirational CEO because he was just, you know, people talk about empathy being like a cool thing these days, but he was just a good guy who made you feel like you were the most important person in the world. And so I knew that day that someday I want to be like Sandy. And so I would every opportunity, I was like, you know, I was so naive. I wasn't, you know, I was okay to take the risk. I would send Sandy a note and say, Sandy, do you have 2 minutes to chat with me? And he'd always say, yes, he humored me, you know, and when I was a young engineer and he was a CEO, and he became my sponsor for life, right? And so I look for like unique things in people that I find so attractive that then I'll say, okay, are you, you know, can you tell me how you do this? So I look for different things in sponsors. You know, I'm not looking just for the next job. Sometimes I'm just learning, how are you doing what you're doing, right? And so I think each one has to figure out what you want from your sponsor. What do you want to learn from them? And then use that opportunity to build a relationship. And I'll tell you, there were more no's than yeses. And so you have to be okay with asking the question when you're looking for a sponsor.
Okay, so it looks like we have time for just about one more question. So both Laura and Pregya have similar questions, and it's about moving on after being someplace for a given amount of time. So they said, you know, how did you process moving from Eaton to Flex after 10 years? And the other side of that was, how do you change careers when you've been in a line of career for some time?
Yeah, I'd say, you know, I, in general, I'm a little bit of an impatient person. Like when sometimes I feel like I've learned, I've done my thing, I want to do something else. But, you know, obviously, as you grow, you know, in your career, you have to be longer and longer periods to give time for results to show and things like that. But I'd say that it takes meaningful thinking to make transitions like that, because you get very comfortable in your situation, in your position. And, you know, I was in Eaton for in my second round for almost 10 years. I was at Eaton, went to Honeywell, came back to Eaton, and then came to Flex. And each time I made the transition, I had to push myself over the edge a little bit to make the transition, because I was very comfortable with what I was doing and I enjoyed what I was doing. And so I think you have to find the moments where you feel like you're ready or you're too comfortable, and you have to push yourself to make those transitions. And my last one was classic. I was with Eaton. I was the chief operating officer running a $14 billion business. It was fantastic being a number two. I'll tell you, you're not in the bullseye. You know what you're doing. And it was, and I loved my job. I loved the people and I loved it. And there was no burning platform to make any change. And as people started calling me for CEO roles, I was like, you know, not really. I'm like very comfortable. My kids are like teenagers. I want to focus on that. And, you know, until it took somebody, the man I'm married to, who had to tell me, is like, really? Like, you're saying no to these things? Like, this is not what you tell every woman who comes to you, right? And so it took somebody to kind of say, you're getting comfortable here. Right. And so I had to find that moment where I was getting too comfortable and say, you know what, you're ready to go and take another move and take a risk. And so find those moments, and, you know, either you're ready or you're too comfortable or something is happening, and force yourself to make those meaningful leaps. And if you're not the kind of person who recognizes it, then surround yourself by people who'll tell you that you need to make those leaps. So I'd say a combination of things.
Okay, thank you again for all of the wonderful insights. This has been a great Q&A session. I will now pass it back to Meghna for closing remarks.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you, Cole, for that. Revathi, once again, a big, big thank you to you, yourself and your team. It's been an honor getting to speak to you. And I genuinely feel like I've received some super valuable guidance and like takeaways from our conversation. I really do value it. I'd also like to thank all our attendees for partaking in today's discussion and raising some very interesting questions. And a final thank you to the club sponsors, the Operations and General Management Club, the South Asian Business Association, Business and Technology Club, and Tepper Women in Business. Thank you as well for fielding a lot of questions that we discussed today. And with that, we'll wrap up today's conversation. Once again, thank you, everyone, especially Revathi. It's been a pleasure.
Thanks. Bye-bye, everyone.